now we know the length of the balance spring. That's usually the timing. But this is a Rolex balance wheel. You can see there, and there are two screws or bolts with a different appearance here. And there, and there as well. These screws are for poising the balance wheel. So same with the front wheel from your bicycle. If there's a heavy point, it will find the lowest point. And then you remove a tiny bit of material there, and then it's poised everywhere. These two are for timing. So then you're not changing the length of the balance spring, but the weight distribution in your balance ring. X balance wheel can go in and go out. And it's very easy to see what's happening, because when they're in, you go fast like that. In, out, slow. In, fast, slow. So the weight distribution in your balance wheel is another way of timing a watch. That Rolex does that. The modern Omegas have the same. That's another way of timing a watch. But here you can see the screws and the two adjustable weights in this balance wheel. But most modern balance wheels are smooth on the outside, so there's no timing from weight distribution of the balance wheel. There are several ways of timing a watch, like Rolex with small weights, but usually 99% is all by these two fingers changing the length of the pendulum of a balance wheel. I just picked up some different balance wheels, but I just checked, they're all from the same movement. These are all from ETA 2400 series, the early ones, 2408. And here you can see the slick balance wheel. Balance wheel with screws, and that I never knew until I went to Neuchâtel to watch step, that the shape of the spokes there and this shape says a bit about the material and the grade of the balance wheel. This balance is far better timed and poised than these. I think this was grade C, and it is grade A. So the shape of the spokes says something about the quality of the balance wheel. And I thought it was nice to show you the different materials of the spring itself. Here you can see the blue ones. This one is from carbon steel, and the shiny ones is Nifarox. And Nifarox, sorry, my German is not too good, is nicht variabel, nicht oxidabel. So stays the same, well, roughly the same with temperature. But because you can understand, if temperature gains and the normal carbon steel expands, the pendulum becomes longer, so the watch goes slower. Just like the tracks of a railroad, they expand with temperature, so the balance spring pendulum is longer, so the watch goes slow. Maybe you can try this later on. That is just quite horrible, but I will show you all the tricks how to even get this one back in shape again. And this one we are going to adjust in a moment. First I'm going to put them in alcohol. I know the shellac of the D shape of the impulse stone can dissolve by alcohol of isopropyl, but it's not going to be in there for long, and the temperature is not too high. So I degrease with alcohol and acetone, and usually that's quite enough. So now I would like to show you a bit more of the different parts of the balance spring. I first want to show you the part on the inside where it's fixed to the balance staff, because that's the only thing holding the balance spring to the balance, and that's so delicate and you can make some mistakes with that. Now I want to show you the collet or ferrule. So this is the part on the inside where it's attached to the balance spring, tiny part. And it's like a C-spring clamping on the balance spring. One side is beveled. Here you can see the beveled edge, and that's always underneath. So it's easier to take it off. I'll show you in a minute. But there's something important here in the collet. There you can see a small hole with a burr. There's a small burr from production because this one is new. But there you can see a hole in the side of the collet. That is something to take into account, because on the other side is the indentation. They can see the hole drilled through one side of the collet. That's what it makes so fragile, because if you try to adjust the collet, it will break just there. There you can see the two holes. That is where the spring is attached to the collet. Four stake pin, a small, I'm not sure what the English translation is for these pins, but that one goes, the spring goes into the hole, and then with this pin you put it there, attach it to the collet. That's it. Now you can see the small pin going through the collet, and first you place the balance spring through the hole, and then you want to secure it with this piece of, I think it's more copper than brass. The top tip. Trust me on this one. If you want to secure it, always pull the small bit in place. Never push it in place, because the very fragile hairspring is there in here as well. If you pull, you move away from the hairspring, and if you push, there's always a chance you go right through the hairspring. Sounds like pure logic, and of course, but it's well worth to remember that. There is a special tool. It works perfectly, and if you buy it, it's really expensive. But once you see this, you're not going to buy it. You're going to make it yourself. Special, just a number 3 tweezer. But if you look, there's a... I removed just a tiny bit of the tip. Do you see that? And that gives you so much more control when doing this. Here you can see the difference in the tweezer. And now you can, if you want to gently push, move it inwards. Do you see the difference? And this is not, you can do this with a normal tweezer as well. But once you cut the pin, remember that on this side there will be the balance spring. So if the balance spring is in here and you want to, well, push it out if you like, then you can apply some force without getting your tip too close to the balance spring. So it gives you clearance from the hairspring. And I know it sounds a bit abstract, but if you're into watchmaking and you have this kind of difficulties, it is a good tip. This really helped me securing some space away from the delicate hairspring. So the tapered bit is always on the bottom, and sometimes you want to adjust. If it's slightly too loose, you want to close the gap a bit. But now you can see there is the gap, and there is a small hole where the pin was just in. So if you want to adjust by just pushing like this, it will crack, yeah, it will break. It will break just there because it's hollow, there's a hole. So you cannot just adjust it like that. That's why you have this block. If you place the collet like this, then you can change the dimensions without cracking it like that. Well, that one is perfect. You can see there is some trouble with this hairspring. Well, balance spring adjustment. There's a few tips I want to give you that I use that helped me through the years. And first thing is be relaxed. If you want to finish it fast, and it's never going to work. First, I drink usually some fruit juice to get my blood sugars level, and just make sure you got some nice music, you sit relaxed, and you're up for it. Because if you don't, there's no use in starting, because it can only go wrong. It's relatively flat still, but here it's a mess. And I want to show you a very simple trick. There are just a few rules for balance spring adjustment. And that is to make it level, because if it's like this, you have to change it. And if it's level, it has to be centered. So just level and centered from the top. I use that one to explain it. If you want to make adjustments to make it level, the hairspring, where the problem is, go back 180 degrees. Look at this. Because 180 degrees from the defect, then you can change the leveling of the hairspring. So if you want to adjust this point, go back 180 degrees. If you want to adjust the level. With centering, if the defect is here, you have to go back 90 degrees, because then you can adjust this point. I hope that makes sense. I will show you in a moment on the actual balance spring, but leveling is 180 degrees. And with centering, it is 90 degrees. I hope that makes sense. Make sure you're okay. Have some drink. Make sure your sugar levels are okay. Then the adjustment, make it first flat in one plane, and then center it. Then, another important rule is always start from the center. There's a start, and you just follow the spring. It's okay. And here is something wrong. No. There it goes outside, because there it goes wrong. Then you only focus on this point. You can see from the center going outwards, here it's still okay, just following the spring, and there is the problem. If you go from the inside and just fix this problem first, and then continue moving outwards, because if you do an adjustment here on the outside, and then you go back inside, the outside is all over the place again. So then you're fighting yourself and you go completely insane. Been there, done that. So you move from the inside out and only attack one problem at a time. For equipment. These tweezers I find so nice. It's not a must-have, but it makes life so much easier. And simply because when adjusting, you can see from the top when adjusting a spring. And there, the tips are nice and sturdy. You can do it with tweezers, of course, but I find these number 6. It's just nice to have. And then the actual bending of the spring. This with the shiny material. The shiny material, the Elinvar or Nivarox, is an alloy, and it's a bit more pliable. So you can bend on the same spot several times. if you have this bluish material, if you bend it on the same spot 3 or 4 times, it will break. So be careful with the bluish material, carbon steel. It will break easily when bending at the same point. I can show you with removing the collet. I got the small levers for removing the hands, and these are the tiniest ones. And even if they're so small, I polished them even more, so they're even more thinner. And remember, the collet has got a tapered bit. Well, you want to remove the collet, that collet, from the balance wheel. So make sure you got the spokes underneath. Otherwise, you'll lift the complete balance wheel. So I've got the levers, and then I go over the spokes and try to pry the collet upwards. And remember, it's a clamping on the balance staff, so you can remove it slightly. There are two ways of removing, because it's a C clamp. If you move a tapered thing in the slot, it goes outwards and then you can move it. But I find there's a risk of bending the collet, and you see it's a friction fit. Thank you, thank Per. I don't want to bend the collet, so that's why I want to pry it upwards and removing it instead of opening it and then taking it out. I hope that makes sense. If I move this one in the slot and pry it open, it will move outwards and then you can adjust it. But I don't like that. I like the levers underneath and then lift it up so it won't open too much. Just a bit of Rodico to secure it, but not touching, of course, the spring. Go underneath. Wiggle, wiggle. And there it goes.